faces with strange sounding names, far away over the sea. Those far away places with a strange sounding names are calling.
Well, I joined up in April 1941, initially to Blackpool, where I did what we called the square bashing, in other words drill, and there we also had our inoculations and our jabs, all the things that we have. I was then sent home for, I believe, between 4 and 6 weeks. We were then recalled and I went out to Morecambe. Morecambe, we did more square bashing, and at the end of 4 or 5 weeks, and we were in civvy billets, by the way, during this time, we were then sent off to our training camp. This was Credenhill in Herefordshire. And my course was a gun armourer's course. In other words, being trained how to maintain, operate, and generally look after guns on aircraft. As well as other guns, as well as the ordinary rifle, revolver, they were all guns, but mainly aircraft guns. I came out of Credenhill training camp on promotion, and my pay went up from a magnificent sum of 1 and 6 pence a day to 4 and 9 pence a day, which I thought I was in heaven at the time. And we were then posted to our stations after a week's leave, and I was posted to Hawarden near Chester. And Hawarden near Chester was a maintenance unit, one half of the airfield, 48 MU, and the other half was 57 OTU, in other words, officer training unit. And it was there that we more or less completed our training, because we were then working on proper aircraft. In Credenhill, we were working only on guns, but not on aircraft. But at Hawarden, we were working on proper aircraft there, fixing guns, maintaining guns, and look after aircraft generally. And that, this included not only fighters, but bombers as well, turret guns, as well as wing guns and this sort of thing. And generally speaking, we were dealing with Browning 303s, these were in the wings of aircraft, and in the turrets of bombers, and 20mm cannon. And they were only in wings of aircraft. And the fighter aircraft that were generally dealt with was the Hurricane. I didn't work on Spitfires, I just worked on Hurricanes. Now, during this time, we were billeted in civvy billets in a little village called Mancott. Not very far away, I'm saying 4 or 5 or 6 miles away. We were bussed in every morning. Anyway, after we were then moved late November to West Kirby. That was a holding camp ready for transport overseas. We were given a week's leave from West Kirby. When we came back off leave, we were then transported to Liverpool, and on the 4th of December 1941, we boarded the Andes. The Andes was a Royal Mail ship, about 18,000 tons or thereabouts. In those days, it was quite a big ship, actually. And there were several hundred of us on there, and we were a mixture of RAF and Army. No one told us where we were going. We had no idea where we were going. Except that one chap, we were stood about doing nothing one day, and a fairly high-ranking officer came on board. In fact, he was a wing commander. And chatting, stood on the rail, chatting to this chap, and where are we going, sir? Well, I can't really tell you where you're going, but I can say that it's going to get a lot colder before it gets a lot warmer. And I thought, well, that's a bit of a queer thing to say. It's going to get colder than this, and it wasn't very hot then in December, I can tell you. But anyway, as it turned out, he was absolutely right. Because we then left Liverpool on the 8th of December. Now, this date should stick in a lot of people's minds because that was the day that the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor. We sailed from there up to Gourock in Scotland to pick up the main convoy. And from there we headed north and west round the tip of Iceland, Greenland, right over to within, as far as I was told, within several hundred miles of the American coast, or actually the Canadian coast. And this, I eventually learned, was to keep away from the German submarines. And from there we sailed back straight across the Atlantic, straight into Freetown in Africa. And we arrived in Freetown on the 22nd of December, 41. And we never left the ship. But there was a lot of interest in the ship because the little, what we used to call bum boys, used to come out in the little fishing rowboats, if you like, trying to sell us anything. They sell us anything from peanuts to monkeys, if you like, I don't know, all sorts of things they tried to sell us. But of course we had no money to buy these things anyway, we couldn't afford that sort of thing. And then we left Freetown on Christmas Day, the 25th. And sailed down the African coast, round the Cape of Good Hope, past Cape Town, and eventually we docked at Durban. On the 12th of January, we changed ships, or boats. and we boarded a 14,000 tonner called the City of Canterbury. Now, the City of Canterbury was quite a famous ship in some ways, because the skipper was a chap called Jones, Potato Jones, which obviously wasn't his real name, but Potato Jones, why? Because during the Spanish Civil War, this particular skipper and this boat used to run potatoes into Spain. He used to run the blockade, and he was really carrying potatoes most of the time. This is where he got his name from. But the trouble with the City of Canterbury was, it had just discharged 1,700 Italian prisoners from the Middle East. And the 1,700 Italian prisoners that had just been discharged made a bit of a mess of the ship. In fact, on the mess decks, as we call them, where we slept at night and whatever, the smell was horrible, and the filth is almost beyond description. I can't say it was ankle deep, but it was certainly over the bottoms of his shoes. Well, we took exception to this, and almost to a man, we walked off the ship and said, we are not sailing on this boat, at least until it's cleaned. And we assembled on the dockside, refused to move, and then an Air Commodore came along, and I can't remember his name, quite frankly. He's a small chap, a rotund little man, very nice man, and he stood on a box or a barrel or whatever in the middle of us lot, and he explained to us that in fact we were sailing to the Far East, and that was the first we'd heard of it, really. The first real confirmation that we'd had as to where we were going. So after, I suppose, about an hour and a half, we decided we would go back on board, and yes, we'd have to clean the place. But there were about 200 absolutely refused to board the ship. And those 200 were left on the dockside as we sailed away. And we were by then about a good hour behind the convoy. They were just a dot on the horizon at that time. Now, these 200 that were left behind were in fact sent straight back to the United Kingdom. Now, we did hear that they were not charged with anything. Now, I can't confirm that because I'm not certain, but this is what we heard, that in fact, to put it one way, they got away with it, but I can't confirm it. But anyway, off we go across the Pacific, and eventually we catch up with the, not the Pacific, the Indian Ocean, isn't it? Yes, it's the Indian Ocean over there. We caught up with the convoy, and off we sailed. Now, it took us until the 3rd of February to arrive at our initial destination, that was Singapore. But going into Singapore, we had a bit of fun. We were bombed. We were bombed for about an hour and a quarter by both high-level and lower-level Japanese bombers. At that time, we were in the Malacca Straits. This is just before you enter the Singapore area. We didn't have a direct hit on our ship, but we had 7 men killed with shrapnel. And the Empress of Asia, she was part of our convoy, a fairly big, she was a big troop carrier. She was hit and beached. And the other ship in our convoy was a French motor vessel, the Felix Russell. Now, the Felix Russell was a very quick ship, much quicker than us. And these days, what I say about it is that the skipper on that particular ship, he just put it into top gear and off he went. And he went like a hare across the ocean, as far as we were concerned. And in fact, we were left entirely on our own. We had the, our escort ship? The Repulse, the battle wagon Repulse. He was our escort ship. But we had on board some mad New Zealand pilots. And they were mad. They were great guys, absolutely wonderful fellas. Because they went and stood on top of the bridge. And this is absolutely true, it's on record. Directing the captain as to where the bombers were coming from, including dive bombers. Now, dive bombers don't just dive with bombs, they're shooting as well. And they were putting themselves in absolute danger. Funnily enough, not one of them was killed. Not one of them. The people that were killed were, in fact, members of the ship's crew. And if it weren't for them, I'm pretty sure that we would have been hit and could well have been sunk. When we got to Singapore, when we got into the docks, docked at Singapore, it was at that time that the Battle of Bukatimi was going on the other side of the island. The Japs had just come across the causeway, and that was a terrible, terrible battle. We never saw it, but this all came out later on. We weren't allowed to leave the docks at all. We could leave the ship, go onto the side of the dock, and whatever we could carry, we could have. But of course, the only thing we carried was drink. Now, bear in mind, I didn't drink. I was only an 18, 19 year old, and drink to me was something foreign. But somebody stuck a bottle in my hand and said, "Here, boy, drink that. It'll do you good." Well, it was gin, in fact, and I just tipped this bottle up and drank it. And the next thing I remember, we were miles and miles out to sea, and I was on a bed near the ship's funnel, out on the top deck near the ship's funnel. How I got there and why I got there, I shall never ever know, but that is a fact. And we actually left Singapore during the night of the 4th. This is following the day after we arrived at Singapore. And we sailed down to Java. And we landed at Batavia on the 8th of February, 1942. And disembarked. And on the 10th, we left Batavia and went to a place called Butenzorg. We were in there, or in Java, to maintain aircraft. But the aircraft we'd gone to maintain were still in crates. They were crated up. They'd been shipped over to Java. And this is the first time that I came in. In fact, they were unshipped, they were uncrated, and they were assembled and put together. And this is the first time, as a gun armourer, I came into contact with a 500 Browning. As opposed to 303, this was a 500. And in my opinion, it was a lethal weapon. Because what we found was that at that particular time, when the gun ceased firing with the breech block in the forward position, with a bullet on the end of it, and the bullet actually in the barrel. Now the Vera is very hot then, and to my mind there was always a danger of the bullet being fired when it shouldn't have been. As compared with the Browning, now the 303 Browning, the English gun, when that stopped firing, the breech block was in the rear position with a bullet on the end, a long way from the barrel of the gun, and there was virtually no danger. It was completely away from the hot spots. From there, we were then moved to a place called Garut. Now Garut was in the hills. It was a train journey, we had a train journey. Now on this train journey, the train suddenly stopped. And we couldn't understand it. We were miles and miles and miles away from anywhere. But we were then told to disembark from the train, walk along the track, and there would be another train on the other side, because what had happened, we stopped at the back of an ammunition train that had just been bombed by the Japanese. And this was in a bit of a mess. And in fact, there were dead bodies all over the place. It was a real mess. And we arrived in Garut on the 29th of February, 1942. In tents, in a tented camp, although we just slept outside, quite frankly. It was quite hot, and we didn't bother sleeping inside. We slept outside. And as I understand it, on the 1st of March, the Japanese landed in Java. And they made three landings in Java. North, east, and south, as I understand it. We didn't actually see that happening because we were in the middle of the island anyway. And on the 8th of March, Java capitulated. We knew that. Word came through that it capitulated. And we were told to stay put in Garut, in the hills. And on the 12th of March, we saw our first Japanese troops. Now, the troops that we saw, they were part of the Japanese Imperial Guard. And some of them, would you believe it, were in fact six-footers. They were very, very big men, some of them. But they were professional soldiers. And my first impression was, well, if this is a Japanese, and we're going to make prisoners with this sort of people, that's fine. They treated us, I can't say like equals, but as near as one can. Their theory was, hard luck boys, you've lost it this time, maybe it'll be your turn next time. Well, that was the impression I took away from this particular place. And we were told to stay there and we would eventually be moved. And in fact, we moved on the 25th of March, so we were there quite a long time. And we moved to Buigloduk in Batavia. Buigloduk was a state penitentiary. And it was from here, after we got sort of bedded in, if you like, that we were sent to work. And our work consisted of repairing all the damage that had been done to the airfield, the nearby airfield. The Japanese had pattern bombed it all the way down the main runway, and they'd blown holes in that, very big holes. It was our job to repair these, and we repaired these by filling in with hardcore rubble, call it what you like, and in fact concreting over the top of it. And that was pretty warm work, because we were out there all day in the blazing sun, and glad to get home at night. And bear in mind, it was then that we realised that living on rice as a main diet didn't bode very well for the effort you could put into work. In fact, it was then that we first initially started going downhill. Not by a lot at that time. You didn't notice it. It was a very gradual thing. And we were only there, well, we were there till the, yes, I'm trying, only there, from the 25th of March till the 10th of October, 42. And that's when we left Batavia. We left on board a Japanese ship and taken back to Singapore. And went into Changi Barracks. Now, Changi Barracks was the big main military establishment on Singapore at the time. And we arrived there on the 16th of October. We were 6 days getting up there. And in Changi Barracks, we did nothing. We didn't do any work. We were what turned out to be waiting onward transportation to somewhere. We didn't know where, but somewhere. And then eventually, we were lined up and marched out of the camp, down towards the docks. And the Japanese were still at the side. We were walking around. You go that way, you go that way, and you go that way, and you go that way. Well, I went that way, and my pals behind me went that way, and it turned out that the way I was sent to Japan, and where the others were sent, they were sent to the Burma Railway. What we now know as a bridge over the River Kwai. And that's where most of those went. So in that respect, I consider myself to be very, very lucky. Very lucky. We didn't know at the time, we had no idea at the time. But since then, reading the history books and talking to other people, we got the best of it at that time. Well, we boarded a ship on the 27th of October. And we sailed away on this Japanese ship for 4 weeks, or as near 4 weeks as makes the difference, because we didn't arrive at Japan until the 28th of November. And we landed at a place called Moji, at the southern end of Japan. And from there, we were moved from the ship onto a train, a railway train. And off the train went, and for 3 days we were sat on the train, and I mean sat on it, because there were not as big as beds on those trains, and the seats were fairly hard. And the toilet was very primitive. The food was rice that came round twice a day. And eventually, after a very, very bumpy ride, we arrived at Hakodate. Now, Hakodate is the third island up. Honshu is a bottom island. Kyushu is a middle island that where Tokyo is, and then Hokkaido. Hokkaido is the name of the island, and Hakodate was the main town. In fact, that was a big shipbuilding yard. And in that part of the world, it was a very big shipbuilding yard, employing an awful lot of people. And we arrived there on the 1st of December. That was the 3 days we were on the train. And went straight into camp. And did nothing for 4 weeks. And in fact, we didn't start work in Japan until the 28th of December, 1942. And we were allocated various jobs. No such thing as, are you musical, sir? No, well, if you are, move that piano. Nothing like that at all. You were just told to go and work there And that was the end of it. And I was directed to what they called wire workers. Now, wire workers to me, I thought, well, he's hauling wires about the place, but in fact, it was nothing like that. What the wire working section did was to prepare ships for launching. After being built, ready for launching, they did the preparation. And part of that preparation was done by divers. Well, I was allocated this job with the diver as the pump man. We used to pump him. It was the old-fashioned pump that just did this. All he did was this all the time. And the divers would go down, hook these pieces of pig iron onto a piece of rope, and we'd haul them up into the vessel and then take them back onto land. And I did that job for a lot of months. There were times when we were in Hakodate that we had what I call fun in inverted commas. I call it fun these days, but at the time it happened, it was very, very serious, because we could have been, well, beaten very badly for doing these things. I don't think we would have been shot, but it would have caused us a lot of grief, that's for sure. What we used to do is steal fish, for one thing, because among other things, we had to unload fishing boats. And these were boats that brought in salmon, great boxes of salmon, and they were very, very heavy. But the salmon was a very nice fish, as you can understand. And what we used to do was to steal these things and bring them back to camp, hidden under our clothing and tied round our necks and down our backs. And why we got away with this, I shall never ever know, but we did get away with it. But then we had the problem of cooking them. So what we used to do, we used to get a wooden bucket, and they were all wooden buckets there. I never saw a metal one anyway. A wooden bucket of near boiling water. Cut the salmon up into steaks, pop it in this water, and leave it overnight. And by the following morning, it was sufficiently cooked to eat, and eat with great relish. It was a marvellous thing, this. That's one thing we used to do. Another thing that we did, there were three or four of us. There was Joris Tidolf, an army chap, a chap named Bill Zander, he was an American army chap, and myself, decided we'd have a look inside one of the ships that were docked. And the only way to get on the ship, because it was berthed stern on, there was a gangplank up the stern over the ship's rail. Excuse me. So Bill Zander and Geordie Stidolf said, right, Ginger, because I did have a ginger crop then. I was a real copper knob. You stay at the bottom of the gangplank, and if you see anyone coming along, shout, and shout loud. We're off. So off they went, disappeared into this ship, and came back after 10, 15, 20 minutes, I suppose, with an octopus, of all the things, an octopus. Now, anything like that to us at that time was food. But we didn't know what to do with it. We hadn't a clue how to cook it. It was silly, really, but it was ever so funny at the time, but it could have been silly. If we'd have been caught, or believe me, we would have been really hammered about that. Anyway, the hancho, or the chap in charge of us, was a young man of early 20s that had his early education in America. And I suppose he sympathised with us to a great extent. And he said to us, look, if you give me half of it, I'll bring it back to you ready to eat. Fine, says us, we will do that, oh, we will do that. And he did. And he came back after several days, maybe a week, maybe more than a week, I can't remember exactly now. But this octopus was cut into, You can imagine the tentacles that, from the octopus, they were in like small circles of about, I suppose, inch and a half diameter. And he pickled them in soya sauce. And believe me, they were a luxury. They're a real luxury, these things. We really, really enjoyed them. And another thing that we did, we were denied salt. We couldn't get salt for anything. And all our food were very bland and tasteless. I mean, white rice just boiled and nothing else with it. It's very bland and tasteless. So we needed salt and they wouldn't give us any. So all right, we'll make our own salt. And we did. What we used to do is to get these square metal cans. They were old, I suppose, 5 gallons altogether of water. And because the way the docks worked in those days, there were fires all over the place for riveters and in fact, in wintertime, just to keep warm, because it was very, very cold up there. And we popped these on the fire and boil it down. And a 5 gallon drum of this stuff would boil down to, I suppose, a good inch and a half of brown crystals in the bottom of the tin. And then, well, brown is brown, but it was salt. We would then add clean water and keep boiling them until we got this something like white, fairly big crystals. And from then on, we used to crush these. We hadn't had a rolling pin, but we crushed them. So that we finished up with good quality salt, like you would buy a sea salt in this country today. With the guards in the prison camp and the military authorities, we were treated horribly. We were treated quite badly. But with the civilians, and there were civilians that were working with in the docks, they were all right. A lot of them were all right. I can't say better than that. Because to a certain degree, they lived under the same conditions that we did. We used to have to work 10 days out of 11. The 11th day we had a day off. And then we worked another 10 days with a day off. And the Japanese people were rationed. All the basic food was rationed, like where we were in this country. The difference being in Japan that the basic food was issued at the place of work. And if they didn't go to work, they didn't get the basic issue. They had to wait until next time. And that was about every 10 or 11 days. So in some respects, they had a certain amount of sympathy for us, but none the more, they were Japanese, we were English, and never the twain shall meet in that sense. And life went on. And then, on the 14th of April 1943, bingo. We thought Christmas had come. We were issued with 1 1/4 parcels each of Red Cross stores, whatever. And this, there were all sorts of these things. There were boots and socks and eats and cigarettes and chocolates and tin food, and it was marvellous. 1 1/4 parcel each, and that was a lot of parcel. That it was quite a big thing. But the next issue, although we were supposed to receive these things on a regular basis, they were never issued to us on a regular basis at all. On the 4th of June 1945, they decided that we were being moved. And we moved up the island to a place called Bibaya. Well, we didn't know what was going on really when we got in this camp. And I suppose this camp, there will be about 400 of us, as I can remember. I can't remember the exact number, but it was about 400 men. And we were split into two shifts. And lo and behold, we were down to coal mines. Now this was a new experience to, I should think, 100% of us, because I can't think that any man in that camp had ever worked in a coal mine in his life, or seen one for that matter. But there we were, off we were marched, a day shift and a night shift. And we walked up to the mine, up the hill, and these were not deep mines, they were what they call drift mines, dug into the side of the mountain. And when we got to the mine entrance, we were issued with our lamps, run off a battery, tied on our belts. And the lamp was attached to the helmet. And we boarded a train, electric train, that carries into the mine, right into the mountain. Now, it has been said that we travelled 5 miles on the train. I don't think it was quite so far as that, but it seemed a long, long way. And it was very, very warm in the mine, very warm, in fact, hot. And the coal face that we started to work when we got down there was 7 feet thick. Now that's a lot of coal, believe me, it's a lot of coal. And we didn't do the drilling. The Japanese did the drilling, the real Japanese miner. He did the drilling. And although the mine itself was electrified, all the drilling was done by compressed air. And it was normal drilling for coal. They're drilling with long steel drills, many feet into the coal face, packing their explosives, clear everyone out, well way back, and then just blow it up. And the whole face would drop down. It was then our job to get this coal out of the mines. And what we had to do was to load the, what they called tubs, in fact the little trains. They would hold, I don't know, I suppose, between 1 and 2 tons of coal each. And it was our job shoveling coal into these tubs, which wasn't very easy. Although it was 7 feet high, the roof, it was so hot and so dusty. And believe me, we had to get out of there in the evening and get some sort of a shower when you got back. And the Japanese always did the shoring up. They did all the shoring of the roof and the sides, because the sides came in as well sometimes. And they were very good at that, except for one incident. And that was the last time we ever worked that 7 foot seam. They'd just blown the face down. We were in there shoveling coal into the tubs. Then suddenly, the roof fell in. And bear in mind that this was rock, not coal, it was rock. And one of my pals in there, Frank Halliwell, he got a piece right across his back, and I understand it broke his back. It didn't kill him, but it broke his back very badly. And they had to be got out. In fact, they got him out. But he was on this little train, and it must have been terrible getting him out of there. He must have been in awful agony. But they did get him out anyway, and he finished up in the hospital. We did have a little hospital block in the camp, and Frank finished up. Now, we never worked that seam again. I don't know why, but the Japanese are very suspicious of things like this, evidently. Well, they certainly were at that time. And we then moved to another seam. Now, bear in mind, we were working 7 feet, which is the height of a normal living room or thereabouts, to a seam 3 feet high. And this seam ran, it wasn't just a heading, it was in the side of the roadway. It was 3 feet high, 3 feet off the ground, so we had to step up 3 feet, then go in, on our hands, almost crawling in there. At the end, there was a coal face at the end, 3 feet high. And this we had to get out with picks and shovels. We were lying on our side, picking away at this thing, for a shift. And this carried on alternately night and day, and for the usual 10 days on, 1 day off, until the 15th of August. Now, as we all know now, that was VJ Day. At that time, we didn't know it. We didn't know what had happened. When we came down that evening, we were on day shift, came down from the manor that evening, we didn't pass the night shift going on and wondered what had happened, because we always pass one another on the way to and from work. But when we got back to camp, everyone was dressed up, and by that I mean they weren't ready for work. And no one could understand this. And then the rumour got around, oh, there's cholera down the mine, and we don't want that to spread. Which was, we know now, was a lot of nonsense. But that was the excuse they gave. And I said, that was VJ Day. And this carried on, this rumour carried on for, till what, 20th of August? Nothing doing at all, no work to do. They didn't make us work. But what they did do, they started giving us more things, like cigarettes and toffee and sugar and even mustard, of all the strange things. We'd never seen mustard, but they gave us mustard. And we did camp fatigue, because the place had got to be kept reasonably clean. We couldn't live in squalor. And we were coming more and more under the influence of our own officers. And then on the 21st of August, Frank was sent to the local hospital. And that, in fact, is the last time I ever saw him. I've never seen him from that day to this. And on the 23rd of August, we were finally told that the war was over. That was 8 days after, in fact, after it had finished. And they gave us all a glass of sake. Now, sake, as you know, is the Japanese rice wine. And never having had alcohol. In fact, I hadn't had alcohol at all in my life, and a lot of the older men hadn't had it for a long, long time. We got a bit tipsy. But nevermore. The ash can, now the ash can was the man in charge, he was the officer in charge, in fact he was a colonel. And he gave us all five cigarettes apiece, which he said he got from his own pocket, but, well. And that night, for the first night, since we were taken prisoner, we went to bed without a camp roll call. We never had a roll call after that. And in the evening, we had a concert in the square. And on the day after, the 24th, I believe that was it, I think I'm right. That's right, we're told on the 23rd, 24th, a Japanese colonel came to visit, a chap named Colonel Imoto. Now again, this was one of these peculiar Japanese that educated in America, extremely well spoken, he'd almost flawless English, and he gave us a speech about the war being ended, hoped that we didn't think too badly of the Japanese, because after all, war is war. And the more I thought about it since then, I realised that war is war, and terrible things happen in war, on both sides of the fence. And he gave us a bottle of beer each. And he drank a toast to peace. And then we were suddenly issued with boots and shirts and socks and tunics. And we got 3 bean bars for tiffin. Now, tiffin is lunch, of course. Now, 3 bean bars, they were only small, like sort of a half a Mars bar in today's terms. But these were marvellous. This was wonderful, wonderful stuff. And all for the next several days, we kept getting more stuff from the Japanese, apparently. More clothing, more food. The colonel gave us another toast on the 25th, again to world peace. And so it went on. And rumours were rife, really, because we'd no idea, we were never told exactly what was happening. We knew the war was over, but we were still in a Japanese prison camp. And although there were Japanese guards there, they weren't bullying us anymore. They weren't issuing orders anymore. And we could wander about the camp. In fact, we could wander about the countryside. We used to go and steal chickens from the farm, and get the farmer to dress them for us. And we'd bring them back and cook them in the cookhouse. Marvellous meals. And in fact, at one time we even went to the pictures in Bibai. It was a French film that none of us could understand anyway, but it was a film, it was different, and that was that. And then, on the date, what date was that? The 28th of August. That was when the real fun started. 2 B-29s came over, American aircraft. And they dropped Red Cross supplies by parachute. Now before they actually dropped the supplies, they dropped a small parcel on the end of a relatively small parachute. It didn't seem to be much bigger than a golf umbrella today, no bigger than that. Anyway, this thing was picked up, and quite frankly, we didn't have a clue what this thing was. But fortunately, we had it with us a New Zealand Commissioned Petty Officer from the New Zealand Navy that had been taken prisoner at Le Tichon. And he knew that this was a walkie-talkie. And there was a note inside this parcel, how to put this thing together and make it operate. And then just talk to us, the aircraft overhead, and tell us, we will tell you what to do. And in fact, what they said was that there's a clearing, such and such a place just outside the camp. Clear that off properly. Put a big cross in there of some sort so that it can be seen from the sky, and leave the rest to us, which we did. And then they started bombing us with parachutes. Oh, there was everything. There was chocolate, there was chewing gum, there was food, there was milk, there was cocoa, there was sugar. And in fact, that night we didn't sleep actually. We stayed up all night. And on the 14th of September, which was a month after VJ Day, we left the camp at 1 o'clock in the morning and travelled to Sapporo Airport. We were loaded onto DC-10s and taken down to Yokohama, a 3.5-hour trip. And we didn't leave Yokohama until the 17th, 2 days after, and went aboard the USS Hesford, and this was used as a barracks. It was a ship that was docked in Yokohama Harbour, used as barracks. And on the 8th, this was used for only one night, really, because the day after we left the Hesford and went on board the USS Haywood. And on the 19th, about 8 o'clock in the morning, we set sail and arrived at Manila in the Philippines on the 25th. We left the ship on the 27th and went to the British camp. And to travel to the British camp, we travelled along the road. I can see this now. There was a very well-to-do place, I would have thought, before the war. But there wasn't a whole house left standing for mile after mile after mile. It had really been bombed almost out of existence. It was a terrible, terrible sight. But none the more. The war was over. And on the 29th of September, we got our first British pay. We were given 40 pesos. And that was equivalent to about £5. Now, tracking back a little over this period of time, this last 2 or 3 years, the Japanese paid us. And we had a pay book. I've still got mine. And we were paid 10 sen per day for every day we worked. And in fact, the pay book was stamped with a Japanese stamp. Now, I can't remember what 10 sen was worth. It was, in fact, a tenth of a Japanese yen. It wasn't worth a lot, but with this, we could buy cigarettes and chocolate bars, or bean bars, as we used to call them. And we stayed there until the 9th of October in the British camp, doing virtually nothing, really. And we boarded the USS Marine Shark. Now, these ships that we were sailing on at this time, the Hesford and the Hayward and the Marine Shark, were they were all welded ships. They'd done away with riveting so that the Americans could construct these vessels much more quickly. But they left a lot to be desired, and they weren't very stable in the water. They rocked and rolled forever. On a calm sea, they were rock and roll, these things. And we left Manila on the 10th of October. And on the 23rd of October, when we were sailing across the Pacific, on the 23rd of October, we arrived at Pearl Harbor. Now, to my mind, by then the wheel had gone full circle. We left England the day they bombed Pearl Harbor. And when we were released, we got back to Pearl Harbor on board an American vessel. We stayed there overnight, in the harbour, didn't leave the ship, and set sail the following morning for San Francisco. And we arrived there on the 1st of November and went into Fort McDowell. And Fort McDowell was on Angel Island. Without the map, I can't explain that really, but it's shown on the American map. Now, the following day, we were then issued with more rations and proper clothing for the journey home. And we were issued with new RAF uniforms. we'd never seen this type of uniform before, because when we'd left England, we had button-up tunics, and these had zips on. We'd never seen this sort of thing before. We were marvellous, this, marvellous. Zip-up tunics? Never heard of the thing. And we took the ferry to Auckland and went on board a hospital train. Now, when we got on board this hospital train, our orders were, when you board, you'll be allocated a bed space, you will get undressed, you will get into bed, and you will stay there till you're told to get out, apart from using the toilet. And this was a fact. They brought our meals to us, and this was all done by American personnel. And after 1.5 days, we arrived at Fort Lewis, at Seattle, and went into barracks about 2 o'clock in the morning, and we were pretty tired by then, I'll tell you, although we'd been in bed. That was on the 3rd. We were there for 4 days. And on the 7th, we were already onto another train, Canadian National Railways. The Canadians had sent this train down from Vancouver to Seattle, over the border into Seattle, to pick us up. And this was, this was 5-star plus from our point of view. And in fact, it was really, really posh. We then had a 5-day journey across Canada, because we weren't allowed to cross America for some unknown reason, and I can't explain it. We were presumed to be stateless until we were repatriated into our own country. But none the more, the Canadians took us right across Canada on a wonderful five-day holiday. They treated us, we might have been the King and Queen of England. They were marvellous. The food we got on that train, we were given menus. We could choose our own food on the train. And halfway across, they changed the dining car. Obviously, they did half the trip across Canada. They worked. One worked one half of Canada, the other worked the other half of Canada. And the night before the first crew was due to change, they sent word round, tell us what you want to eat tonight as individuals, and we will produce it. And believe me, there's some funny things to ask for. But we all got what we wanted. By golly, did we. And then during this journey, we used to stop periodically at various places, and the people knew who we were. It was very cold, because this was winter time. Snow was very deep, in the especially when we came through the Rockies. And they gave us everything. They gave us all sorts of things. I don't recall getting any alcohol, but we certainly had Coca-Cola and soft drinks with cases, not just bottles, with cases each, under our beds, or our seats, really, because although the seats were turned into beds in the evening. And we actually did absolutely nothing on the train. We were treated as real, real holidaymakers. And that took us to the 12th of November. 5 days from the 7th to the 12th. And we left the train, we arrived at a place called Wee Hawken. Now, that was on one side of the Hudson River. We left the train at midday. We crossed the Hudson on a ferry and boarded the Queen Mary. at about 1:30 in the afternoon. On the following day, we left New York at midday on the way to England. And we landed England, Southampton, on the 18th of November, 1945. And what a sight. Friends and relatives were there to meet us. My Uncle George was there. My stepfather. I'm sorry, I get a bit emotional about this because it was a very emotional time, I can tell you. We've been away for 4 years or more, been through all sorts of difficult times. And although we left a lot of men behind, we were home. And back with their families. Well, we were out off the ship and greeted our families on, well, as one can imagine we did. And we boarded our trains and we went to a camp called Credenhill. Yes, back to Credenhill. Our families went home. We were in Credenhill overnight. The following day, we were issued with travel warrants, new service books, and sent on our way. And we had to report back on January the 20th, if I remember rightly. I think it was the 20th of January, we had to report back. And we came back on the 20th of January for the mob. Now, we weren't demobbed like other personnel who hadn't been prisoners of war. We were demobbed immediately. We didn't have to wait until our category came up or whatever they call it. But we were demobbed immediately, re-kitted out, issued with our civilian clothing, and sent on, from my point of view, 13 weeks leave. In other words, I had 13 weeks holiday and then I was free to start work to do whatever. In fact, this is what happened. In fact, I started work 12 weeks after I got home. Back to my old firm, Baxendale Brothers and Chorley. That was the end of my war.